Welcome to Jung Tuition. Let's continue our discussion on Veritasium's big misconceptions about electricity. Battery. We use a battery almost every day. But do you really understand the physics behind the battery? Well, this question sounds a little bit insulting. So what are you talking about? Do you treat me as a kid? No, I'm serious. Because today I'm going to share you with the Professor Lewin's lecture on the electrical battery. Let's go.
We have often talked about power supplies, which are devices which maintain a constant potential difference.
That is a very good definition about the power supply or battery. Remember, to maintain the potential difference across the load.
Here we have such a power supply. Potential difference.
Just talk about the battery.
This be the plus side, and this be the minus side.
Okay.
I'm going to connect this. I have a resistor here, R. And as a result of this, a current will start to flow in this direction.
So far, so good. The current go from the positive electrode while the resistor return to the negative electrode of battery. What's next?
So in the power supply, the current flows in this direction.
Oh yes, that is exactly what I mentioned in my one of my short video recently.
Resistance, the current flows in this direction. In what direction is the electric field? The electric field always runs from plus to minus potential.
Yes.
So right here in this resistor, the electric field is in this direction, from plus to minus. But inside the supply,
yes,
it must also go from plus to minus.
How?
And so inside the supply, the electric field is in the direction that opposes the current.
First of all, he assumes there's internal current running from the negative side to the positive side. However, he also noticed that the electrical field is against this internal current he defined.
So some kind of a pump mechanism must force the current to go in.
Aha, pump mechanism. If you go to my video, you will see that it is wrong to use the water pump to as an analog for the DC battery. It's not a water pump. The fluid is not continuous in the battery.
Inside the supply against the electric field.
Oh.
A boulder does not all by itself move up a hill.
True. So how much energy would be spent to bring this current from negative to the positive? While in the meantime, you have to keep the electron load working. Do you have to double your capacity of this chemical battery?
And so something is needed to push it. You remember with the Van de Graaff, we were spraying charge onto a belt. And then we rotated the belt, and the belt forces the charge into the dome. It had to overcome the repelling force of the dome. So work had to be done.
Now this is different, okay? Van de Graaff static field is built by just separate the positive and negative sides physically. But in this case, the battery you are discussing is actually a chemical galvanic seal. You cannot compare with these two devices.
So the energy must come from somewhere. And in the case of the Van de Graaff, it was clearly the motor that kept the belt running. In the case of the Rimhurst, it was I who turned the crank. So I did work. In the case of common batteries, the ones that you buy in the store, it is chemical energy that provides the energy. And I will discuss.
True, it is chemical energy stored in the battery. Now, if you want to spend that much of energy to force the current to go from negative to the positive, how much chemical energy has left? Professor? Hello?
A current is flowing in this direction through the resistor from the plus side of the battery to the minus side. That means inside the battery, the current is flowing. And the electric field here is in this direction from plus to minus, but also inside the battery, the electric field must be from plus to minus. So you see again, as we saw here, that the electric field is in the opposite direction of the current. You will have here SO4 minus ions, and you have copper plus ions in this solution, and here you have zinc plus, and you have SO4 minus. And as current starts to run, SO4 minus ions, which are now the current carrier inside this battery, is going from the right, they're going from the right.
No, that is the result. It's causality here. The reason they got iron left because the copper was taken away, was reduced to copper atom, sorry.
To the left. Now, why would SO4 minus ions travel through an electric field that opposes them, that opposes their motion? And they do that because in doing so, they engage in a chemical.
Look, when he talk about this simple principle of the galvanic battery, he constantly looking at his notebook. It would appear that he had no in-depth study of this galvanic battery before he delivered this lecture this time.
Which yields more energy than it cost to climb the electric hill.
Well, this is a principle, yes. In order to move against the electrical field, yes, extra energy must be spent.
And it precipitates onto this copper bar, so it's like copper plating.
True.
On this side, you get an increase of SO4 minus. Therefore, you also must get an increase of zinc plus.
Yes.
Because again, this liquid there remains neutral. And that means that some of the zinc is being dissolved.
The zinc atom has become ion, while its two electrons were taken away by the copper to form the current through the electric load. That is the point. Electron run away and zinc ion formed.
So you get an increase in the concentration of the zinc. So the charge carriers inside this battery, the SO4 minus ions, travel through this barrier and they go from here to here. So they travel through an electric field that opposes their motion. And this happens at the expense of chemical energy.
That is not true. It's not true. That's imaginary. And in your case, that they got the negative ion on both sides identical. Why does the zinc ion, positive ion, take trouble to marry the negative ion on the other side of the burning wall?
Now, when the copper solution becomes very dilute, because all the copper has been plated onto the copper, and when this becomes concentrated, the zinc plus, then the battery stops.
Actually, he's mixed with the function of the salt bridge. I will mention that issue later on. And in this case, actually, as he demonstrated that, we can build the battery without using the salt bridge.
And now what you can do, you can run a current in the opposite direction. So you can run a current now in this direction. You can force a current to run with another external power supply. And now the chemical reactions will reverse.
It is not true. Electron is actually taken away to form the electric current. On the other side, electron return to this part and they immediately make the copper ion form the copper atom. That is a chemical reaction. So the current is formed externally by the running electron. It has nothing to do with the internal diffusion of ion on both sides.
This is my zinc plate, and this is my copper.
He's going to demonstrate how to put the two galvanic cells in series so that you can double the voltage, double the potential difference.
And you're going to see the voltage displayed.
Oh, by the way, this is a good example that the battery, the galvanic battery, works without the use of salt bridge. Of course, it's a short-lived.
Batteries I have here. One whereby I have copper and zinc. And I have another one.
Is it represent the notation of battery by illustrating the two galvanic cells? If so, obviously he made a terrible mistake. He treated that a copper side is a negative side. That's due to the wrong naming system in chemistry. The copper side is called the cathode.
Connect this one, and you will see now that the EMF will double. Are we ready for that? This is my second one. It's going to be completely independent. So here comes the other two plates. Make sure that I have the copper and the zinc not confused.
Let us stop here. So basically, that is the point. I want to draw your attention that he actually misinterpret how battery work. If I just illustrate a little bit, when you use a battery in your DC circuit, right? And when we got to the current, so the current will form from positive to negative and return to negative. This setup is exactly the same using the DC power supply. So this is positive and negative. And these go to your transformer, or before that you have probably the diode. And that is how this thing that go to this go to your AC power supply. So this simple DC circuit is exactly equivalent to this power supply. We know that the current is go that way, and so does this one. So the current go all the way from the power supply and then return to the power supply. Do you think that we have to make sure there is a current from negative to the positive? Certainly not. So this is a good example that the issue addressed is not that trivial. I will put the link of these two relevant video here so that you can understand what I'm talking about. Goodbye.